Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Give God all the glory.
Amen.
Amen. He wants to deal with your heart today. Are you ready to receive what God has for you today?
Yes.
There's healing in this place today. Your heart's going to be touched by God, and He's going to change some things in you like never before. I had a service in Russia that I've never been in a service like that before. And the Holy Spirit just started calling people up, and I just started praying over them and speaking in tongues. And I said, there's no interpretation, and they just fall out in the Spirit. And I don't know, have any idea what the results of that was. But I found some places, the Holy Spirit started showing me some places in Scripture where we've just left that kind of thing out of the church. That if we think if there's not an interpretation, then it can't be God. And I'm going to tell you what, the Holy Spirit is doing some things in you by Himself. And nobody else is going to get the credit for it but Almighty God. And God's the only one that can change it inside of you, because He's the only one that deals with your heart. And today He's telling me that He's going to get rid of your disappointments. And that spirit of disappointment that has held you back and held you down is dealing with Him today. And He's going to remove that disappointment from you. In fact, He's already started. He's already moved. And I need you to go over to Psalm 112 with me. Just come over here and get a little bit closer to me, okay? Y te todo son a ver a tele, que sabe como de madre. El padre me dice na hasoto lo sirvite. I am changing the hearts of my people. I am moving in the midst of them to make them stronger than they have ever been before. I have done this with you before. You got to be up here on the front row this morning. Come on up here. Just find your seat in the front row, because the Holy Spirit's working on you. And He's changing things in you. And Carol Ball will never be the same again. This message started out to be a heart ruled by peace. And I think the end result of what God is going to put in your heart today is peace. But the other title I got for it was A Heart Completed by Peace. And, Kirby, I didn't know if you'd be here today or not. You and in your family, disappointments are being taken away. The soul of my man is being changed. The soul of what God wants to do in your household is being changed. There's a corporate anointing that flows in your house, and it'll be stronger than it's ever been before. And it's for the whole household. And for those who come to visit you, they will come into your house and they will receive of that anointing. That will be one of the major places where you minister to people and minister to children and the children's children. It's not by might, it's not by power, but it's by my Spirit, says the Lord. And I will do it. I will do it. And you know, the other day when I wrote to you and I said, are you ready to play tennis? I felt like God was saying, I want you to move that side of your body, you know, from where you lost. Psalm 112. I'm going to ask you to stay in this psalm for a month. Because if you get this psalm down in your heart, everything else will be taken care of. This is the fire of God today. And I've never seen it this way before. But I am shrinking the problems and the hurts and the pains that have been in your life. And I'm calling you into the miraculous like you have never known before. And for some of you, this has been a struggle. But the struggle is going to end. Because I'm taking away the disappointments and I'm taking away the things that have bothered you and hurt you. And even the length of time that you've had to wait on me is going to change. Because I am going to service my people like never before. As there was a program on TV, Billy Graham and Gloria Copeland. And she called the guy out from the audience. He was losing his pancreas. His pancreas was literally shrinking and deteriorating. And it was getting smaller and smaller. And they told him, if we don't operate on you and get this to stop, then without your pancreas, you'll die. And they tried to operate on him, and when they got him on the operating table, they just closed it back up. And a couple of days later, the doctor went in to see him. And he said, you don't need me anymore. The doctor said that. And he said, what are you talking about? He said, when we opened you up, you had a whole pancreas. God had just given you a new pancreas. The doctor said that to him. And he said, well, when do you want me to come back? He said, you don't need to come back, just go home. He couldn't even realize what had happened to him. God had just given him a brand new pancreas. So God's dealing with your heart today. And God's going to minister to your heart today. And you know, I talked with Miss Daniel a month ago. I said, I've got about 14 pages, so I can't finish this. And this is something else that's just turning into a series. When I thought it was just going to be one message, you know. But God's got some things to say to you. And you need to open your heart, your ears, and your eyes and see them the way God is saying them. This started Friday night about midnight. And at 2 o'clock in the morning, Linda came in and shut the light off. I said, okay, God, I need some time to go to bed. It was just so strong and it was just so good. And then last night I went back in there and I thought I had a whole message. And I said, oh, yeah, I see that. And he showed me something else. So this is not going to be complete today, but we'll go where we can. He said, oh, no, Kobe Jack. There's people watching this today that are going to have their hearts changed, that God is going to repair, and God is going to remove those things that have gotten back in your heart. And some of you don't know me, but I'm the God that changes your heart. And if you invite me into your heart, I'll take it. and I'll move in your heart, and I'll change you, and then I will heal you. I'll heal the broken things that have broken your heart, and I'll heal the other parts of you that have weary, that have given up on me. And I'm asking you today, don't give up on me. I'm asking you today, don't give up on me. Keep pushing into me. I got you. Praise ye the Lord. Blessed is the man that fears the Lord, that delighteth greatly in his commandments. Now, I know we're being taught a lot of things from the New Testament. But you can't just leave out the Old Testament. This is a part of what God said was samples and examples to us. And just because you see it in the Old Testament, and he says, keep my commandments, then apply that to the New Commandments. And apply that to the Ten Commandments that are hidden in your heart. Jesus didn't just wipe them out. They're hidden in your heart. And those Nine Commandments are there, and the only one that changed was about the Sabbath. And you can make every day the Sabbath. I think he did that for the Pharisees and the Sadducees, you know. I'm going to make every day the Sabbath. Then you can't fuss about me even on the Sabbath day. That's just my thinking. His seed shall be mighty upon the earth. The generations of the upright shall be blessed. Wealth and riches shall be in his house, and his righteousness endures forever. You don't have a way, if you know Jesus, to stop being the righteousness of God. You don't have a way to cut him off from you. I know we talk about, some people talk about, you can lose your salvation. I don't agree with that. I'm the righteousness of God forever. And I'm not losing my salvation. And I've made the choice. And I've done some choosing, but I'm going on with the Lord, whatever he's got. Amen. Whatever he don't got for me, I'm still going on with the Lord. I told him a while back, I said, Lord, I don't have any other direction to go in. Amen.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I don't want any other direction to go in. There's nothing else other than you. If you send me into a country and they kill me, then that's where you sent me, and it's time for me to come home. Hello? A righteous man doesn't die. He just leaves this planet, goes to another planet called heaven. Telling you, if you get this 112th psalm, then you've got to be saved. His seed shall be mighty upon the earth. I see that working with my son. If you look at your children, you see the mightiness of God working in those kids. They may not know it as much as you do. His seed is working in those kids. And if they're sick or something wrong with them, then they got a problem with their heart. There's a disappointment or something in there that don't belong in there. And God's the only one that can get it out. All you can do is show it to them, but God's got to get it out of them. And if they're broken from you know, I had a lady, this is not going where I wanted to go, but that's okay. And I had a lady would say from 3 to 5 times. And every time she would come, she'd be crying. And then while I was at home, getting ready for the next trip, and I knew I was going back to that church, the Lord showed me her face. And he said, her spirit is broken. And I want to repair her spirit. Well, the things that had happened to her, and one of them was disappointment. And one of them was, there was so, just so many things that she was sorrowful about. And it was earthly sorrow. And when when we got there, I told her, I said, come up here. I didn't wait on her to come crying. I said, come up here. She's crying. And I had her pastor's wife up there with me. And I said, lay your hands on her. And we just prayed over her, for her spirit to go from broken to wholeness. And just like that, she stopped crying. She came back later in the service, no tears. And she says, please pray for my husband. I said, what's the matter with your husband? And she told me, and we prayed about it. I saw her at least 3 more times in the course of a year and a half. No more tears. She started growing in God. Those things that come against your heart are to destroy your heart. And it's Satan trying to destroy you. And Satan has to get his kingdom back. Satan's trying to get what God has possessed now and get it back. So there's a war between your spirit and your soul. But Jesus has become the shepherd and the bishop of your soul, and his rod and his staff are comforting your soul. And he's working on your soulish realm, which means your thinking has got to change and there's got to be renewal. That's why I'm saying, if you'll take this 112th Psalm and put your life in it for 30 days, make a seed and plant a seed from the 112th Psalm. And say, Lord, I want this in my life. I want these things for the generation that's come out of me. And I want these things for what you want to do in me. There's change here today. I don't know how else to tell you that. I'm shaking inside. I just His seed shall be mighty upon the earth. The generation of the upright shall be blessed. And Jim was talking about somebody he saw on TV this morning, and he said, he was talking about the blessing, and the next thing he started talking about was the anointing. If you're blessed, you got the anointing. If you're anointed, you got the blessing. Amen. Can't get away from either one of them. They go hand in hand. Wealth and riches shall be in his house, and his righteousness endures forever. Well, if his righteousness endures forever, then the wealth and the riches is there forever. You don't have to worry about making it a month, making it a week. How am I going to pay the next bill? You just got to get into this and let God do what he wants to do for your household. Amen. This is talking about your entire family. This is talking about those loose ends that you don't have anything to do with it anymore, because they don't think the way you do it. And they're always laughing at you, and they're always doing this, and they're always making fun of you, and so forth. But those are loose ends. And they need to know this song. Verse 4, unto the upright there ariseth light in the darkness, and he is gracious and full of compassion. righteous. Verse 5, a good man showeth favor and lendeth. He will guide his affairs with discretion. That verse is from Deborah Waters. When she was saying she wanted things tonight. Surely he shall not be moved forever. The righteous shall be in everlasting remembrance. Surely he shall not be moved. Surely he shall not be moved. Surely he shall not be moved forever. The righteous shall be in everlasting remembrance. He shall not be afraid of evil tidings. His heart is fixed, trusting in the Lord. Now, the first question I have is, do you have a fixed heart? Is it fixed on the Lord? Or do you have a plan B and plan C and plan F and plan X? You know, how many plans do you have if God doesn't come through? That's not the way to think. God is going to come through. That credit card is not going to get charged anymore. That savings account is not going to get to zero. God is going to come through. See, when your heart is fixed, it's secured, it's placed. It's a secured place. The heart is fixed. It's a secure place. The heart is fixed. It's a secure place. It's fastened. It doesn't have any other direction to go in. It doesn't have anything else to depend on except God. Not afraid. He shall not be afraid of evil tidings. He shall not be afraid of devil tidings. His heart is fixed, trusting in the Lord. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Go out and do good. Go out and do something good. If it gets like, okay, God, I can't see you working, then go out and do something good. Go out and give something away, or go out and buy somebody lunch, or go out and get the line at McDonald's and pay for the one behind you. Whatever you got to do. A fixed heart is a stationary heart. I said a fixed heart is a stationary heart. It's not moving around. It's not stationary like you're writing on. It's stationed. God can depend on that heart all the time. He sees that heart. He knows what that heart is doing. And he knows the way the enemy is trying to get that heart back. And disappointment is one of the big ones. But this fixed heart is constant, it's stable, it's steady, it's unchanging. It won't change. Jesus Christ is same. It won't change. I am God, I change not. You're just like God in your heart. That heart is fixed. It's not broken anymore. That lady, when she got the heart changed, when she got her spirit fixed, that was in her heart. The hidden man in her heart was fixed. I don't know all the reasons why the spirit would be broken. She had accepted Jesus. But I'm sure somebody could be mean enough to her to break her spirit. Or it could be the other way around, and the guy has got his spirit broken by a mean woman. But God's the healer, and God knows what's going on. And he's got some things to say in your spirit. Nobody will touch your heart but me, the Spirit of God. And she said that in several languages. Verse 8, his heart is established. He shall not be afraid. See, the fear comes up twice. How, if your heart is fixed, it's still got the ability to be fearful. If your heart is established, it's still got the ability. He's saying, don't be afraid. I know you haven't seen me. I know you don't know everything I'm doing, but I've got you in my hands, and nobody's going to take you from me. And Jesus said he said, you're in my hands, and my Father is stronger than I, and he's got you in his hands, and no one will take you out of his hands. Amen. Jesus said that, and it can't be changed because he's the Word. Now, by the Spirit of God, the progression of your life is increasing, and it's being multiplied, because I don't have time to add anymore. Mm-hmm. I've got to begin to multiply and increase you like never before. So submit yourself to me and make yourself available to me. I'm not going to hurt you. I'm going to love you, and I'm going to change you, and you're going to become a lover of people and a fisher of men like never before. See, the heart has to be established in verse 8. The heart is established. He shall not be afraid until he sees his desire upon his enemies. You're going to see the desire of those people who are your enemies. You're going to see them. You know what that's going to be? You're not going to see something bad happen to them. You're going to see them come and bow before you and say, I'm sorry I did so and so. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. There was a man in this church that came out of Baptist church. And when he got filled with the Holy Spirit and his wife got filled with the Holy Spirit, and I would say things, and I talked about the charge that was in Timothy. And he went home and he said, where's the charge in Timothy? He went, and he was saying things about me that weren't true. And I would feel those darts in my back. And after a while, I knew who it was. And then one Sunday morning, we were taking communion. And he came up and he stood right here and he knelt down and he said, please forgive me. I've been talking about you and I've been saying things against you because I didn't believe them. But you were right. And see, when you have a heart for God, forgiveness is not hard. It took me seconds. And I forgave him and wrapped him up in my arms. Now, this established heart, there's some questions that have to be asked. If your heart is established, are you growing and flourishing successfully? Or are you in it a little bit and out of it a little bit, in it a little bit and out of it a little bit? Because the established heart grows, and flourishing is part of what not only faithfulness is doing, but the obedience to Almighty God is so real and so true and so deep that he just takes care of everything. and flourishing, growing is marked by vigorous and healthy growth. You see it. Other people see it in you. They know. They know you love them. Not because you say so, just because you're around them. And they sense that love from you all the time. I sense that from Rodney a lot of times when I come in here. I put my hand on the top of his head. He's like a crystal ball. Now, this established part, is it growing? Is it healthy growth? Or are you condemning yourself and condemning other people? See, are you still guilty? And are you still ashamed of yourself for something that you did in the past? And your past is not under the blood. Does he come through his testing time with success? This is the established part. When God is testing you, is it successful on your part? That's the question only you can answer. You can. See, flourishing is part of your career. James 3, 13. Who is a wise man and endureth with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. But if you be bitter, envying, and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descended from above, and not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envy and strife is, there is confusion in every evil work. See, that's keeping you from being established. And that kind of a work starts in your heart, and it's keeping you from being healthy. Okay? God comes and makes you whole. He's making you whole to serve. He's making you whole, not just for pleasure, but he's making you whole to serve. Okay? The wisdom that is from above, verse 17 of James, from above is pure, peaceable, gentle, easy to be entreated. It's easy for your heart to take these things. It's easy, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. Now look at the last 18. The fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. So what kind of sowing are you doing? Are you still angry? Are you still violent? Those things are not of God. That's not an established heart. That's a heart that's broken. That's a heart that's missing things. That's a heart that's on its way to die. He had dispersed, verse 9. He had dispersed, given to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. Here we are back to that righteousness again. See, when God made you the righteousness of God, Jesus took the sin. Jesus took it forever. Jesus turned around and gave you his life. And that life is righteousness. And it's up to you to live in that righteousness and produce through that righteousness and have fruit, and fruit abundantly. Well, if your heart's messed up, you can't bear fruit. There was a young lady here that spent 11 years in prison. But you know what I loved about her? Her heart. What was her name, Betty?
Deborah Gates.
You can sit down and talk to her.
her and just in seconds, you knew her heart was right with God.
And it still is.
And it's still that way, yeah. She gets up and I have the phone and an hour later we're still saying, we gotta go, we gotta go. Righteousness endures forever. His horn shall be exalted with honor. Your horn is like a, you remember the what they call that thing, looked like a horse that had a horn on the front of it?
Unicorn.
Unicorn. They had that tusk or whatever you call it on the front. That's your horn. Your horn is your anointing. Your horn is what God is going to pull up from out of you as the treasure of Almighty God. Your horn is going to come flying out of you and touch other people. Your horn, young lady, is the way you're going to react. And the power of your anointing that's coming out of you is going to affect other people. There's going to be fire and glory. And the more glory that you get, the more peace you get. And the more peace you get, the more glory you get. And the more your heart is being changed from glory to glory because he puts more of himself in there. I will exalt you with honor, says the Spirit of God. I want to do that. I want that to happen to you. I want to exalt you in honor, Miss Carol. I want you to be honored for me. Because I know you will turn around and honor me. I want to exalt you. I'm building a treasure in you, and I'm making you so strong that you cannot fail, you cannot fall, you cannot stop doing what I have for you to do, Miss Jenna. Now look at verse 10. The wicked shall see it and be grieved. Well, the same way the Pharisees and the Sadducees used to be grieved at Jesus, it's going to be the same way with us. But, the righteous are going to see it and be changed from glory to glory by what you are allowing God to do in you and the change that's coming to you. And it's every part of you. It's everything you consist of. And this is the outpouring of that grace. You see what I'm saying about Psalm 112? It's all there. And the wicked are the ones that are going to fall all around you. 1,000 on my side and 10,000 on my right hand. But it shall not come near me. Psalm 91. And then that man turns around and it says, God says, because he sets his love on me again, I put the word again in there. I said, God, I know I'm adding to your scriptures, but again, I'm setting my love on you. Come on. And you can't stop the Holy Spirit from talking to you in tongues. You can't stop the Holy Spirit from telling you, hey, I want to talk to you. And then he goes to talking in the Spirit. And you don't have any interpretation, but so what? You know he's talking to your spirit. And you know he's talking to you, and he's doing something on the inside of you. And we've cut that off because we said without an interpretation. Now, let me talk about two conditions for your heart. Both of them, he's saying not to be afraid. And if
afraid of the sin in verse 7 of evil, then you shouldn't be afraid of the devil. Because he's the one that comes with the evil. Your heart is fixed, trusting in the Lord. In verse 8, your heart is established, and he shall not be afraid. See, when you know that you know that you know you're established in the Lord, that you know he's got you, there's no place else for you to go but him. There's no place else you want to go but him. You know it. And food doesn't satisfy you. TV doesn't satisfy you. A new dress doesn't satisfy you. New pair of shoes is just that. It's a new pair of shoes. They got to be broke in. They don't satisfy. And catching the biggest fish doesn't satisfy you. I asked him if he was ready to play tennis. He said, no, but I go fishing. if I knew how to drive the boat and he left me, we probably would have went fishing. Now, there's some other places we've got to go into here. And I'm not going to try to do all this today, because there's just no way. But when you get your see the condition of your heart is feeble until the Lord removes those things, the disappointment, the waste. In some cases, your heart is even paralyzed because of what the enemy has done to you. You know how that comes out of me? See, I'm walking in this because God's healing me too. And Linda asked me a question last night. She said, is your heart established in God? And I was able to say, yeah. Yeah. But it's because of the decisions that I made when I was sitting with him all alone, with the Lord. And I was reading some of this stuff and I said, wait a minute. You're the only one that makes a difference. When from the time you changed my life has not been the same. And you took 30-something years to get the garbage out of me, but you got it out. You were faithful to get it out of me. And you're still working on me, and you're still faithful to me. And you're the only one I want to serve. You're the only one I'm going with. See, here comes the Holy Spirit again. I'm changing you for my glory. I'm changing you, woman. I'm changing you. And your heart is established in me. And you've always wanted my way. And now you're going to get my way. Like never before. And those things that you cannot fix, give it to me. Put it in my hands. Those things that you cannot fix, come on, give them to me. And they leave you. And your heart is repaired today. Yeah. Your heart is made whole today by me. And it's fixed. And I'll tell you what I'm saying to you in the spirit. And there'll be times when you wake up and all you'll be able to do is pray in the spirit. And it won't be for anybody else, it'll be for you. He's telling you the same thing, young lady. I mean, you have messages hidden in your heart that have never come up yet. You hear me? But I'm gonna draw them. I'm gonna pour them out of you. You need to get ready to write. And I'm not talking about a book.
will just write down the things that he says to you and put them in some kind of order.
When the heart needs to be repaired, it's in a weakened condition. And I know it's not the same place as the physical heart, but when things are destroying your spiritual heart, they are affecting your physical heart. The same way when I used to hurt on my left side, or I used to hurt and had a pain over here or a pain over there, and God dealt with something in the spirit, and it was gone in the spirit, the pain was gone with it. Hello? It's no different. It's no different. There is a connection. How much of it from one heart, from the hidden man of the heart to your physical heart, I don't know. But see, your first love is holding on to your heart. Hello? If he's your first love, then he's got your heart. And he's wanting to bring a ministry out of you. And you know that there's times, I don't know if you ever feel that or not, I feel like there's times when he's just throwing me up. You know, he's just throwing me up in the air. And then he'll say to me, I got you in my hands. But it's like the Lord's having fun, you know. Hello. And those things would cut off from me. I don't mean that disrespectfully to anybody else. But I wasn't having a lot of fun. And now in place of these disappointments, he's putting joy. And he's putting his presence there. Instead of those disappointments. And you got to deal with those today. You've got to deal with those disappointments. They're keeping you in a weak status, and they're making you exhausted. That's part of where your exhaustion comes from. Is those things you've been disappointed in. And they sap you and just take your strength away from you. And it's got to do with your spiritual heart. See, this is damage that Satan is doing to you to prevent you from fulfilling your course with Almighty God and finding your destiny. I need to say that again. You know, Shelby comes in here and she says, well, it's got nothing to do with age. That's exactly right. It's got nothing to do with age. It's got to do with the condition of your spiritual heart. It's got to be fixed, and it's got to be established. And you're involved in both of those conditions. You know, the fixed heart is an unchanging heart. And you need to make sure you're not double-minded, because the double-minded man won't get anything from the Lord. And if it took me 20 years to get Linda involved and getting me out of debt, then who am I? 20 years to God was not even a day. Hello? But I know one thing, I'm not dying until he's done with me.
Amen.
I'm not letting the weakness of this flesh cause me to die before he's done with me. And I got a bike at home that I'll ride. And I got some 5-pound weights that I'll use. You know, when they say exercise doesn't get you much, well, sometimes it keeps your blood flowing. Hello? You can't be feeble. The night won't be feeble. I break the power of you being feeble in Jesus Christ's name. And see, this thing about the glory, right, listen to Scripture. Zechariah 2:9, the glory of this latter house shall be greater than the former, says the Lord.
of hosts. And in this place will I give peace, says the Lord of hosts. He's using the Lord of hosts' name twice. And Jehovah Shalom is the God of peace. So what's he saying? In the early house, I didn't have that heart. They weren't born again. But now, I got a house that's born again. And I got your heart. And I'm telling you that as you get into my glory, I will quicken your heart and change your heart and exercise my will in your heart like never before. Are you hearing what the Lord is saying today? You back down, my brother? And you know, something that you need to hear. Just because you're young doesn't mean you're set aside.
That's right. Right.
You rise up out of where you are right now. There's times when you need to be being bold and you're not being. Because, well, I'm too young for that. No, you're not. You're right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Become established as the flowers in the garden. Peace beyond all understanding. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. So if Christ Jesus wants to talk to you in the Spirit, who's to stop that? He's greater than all understanding. Love surpasses knowledge. And the Holy Spirit loves you. Sometimes I want to talk to you. Sometimes I want to minister to you. Sometimes I want to be gracious to you. And nobody else involved in it but me, but me and you. Because that's the personality of God. And see, these conditions of your heart, they are ruling in your life. And let the peace of God rule in your heart. Rule is regulating the heart. When you let peace rule in your heart, you're regulating the heart of Almighty God. Why would Jesus say, "My peace I leave with you"? Why? Because he wanted to regulate your heart, your spirit. I don't want you up one day and down the next and all over the place. This man knew what was happening in Psalm 112. He knew what was coming in his family, and he knew what was going to happen through his righteousness. Hello? And he knew what to do with his giving and what not to do. And he used discretion in his life. You know what I think that is? When I'm riding to Walmart or Kroger, and there's somebody sitting over there in the corner looking for an offering, the discretion of God. And one lady, she was so grateful for what I gave her, and she said, "Oh, that'll help buy me a ticket." I said, "What are you trying to get a ticket for?" She says, "Just to go to Atlanta." I said, "How much is it?" And she told me how much it was. And when I left there, I said, "Lord, I'm going to get her some more money and get her a ticket." He said, "No, don't do that, because she won't spend it on a ticket. She'll spend it on other things." That was discretion. See, but I was checking in with the Lord. I wasn't going to do it if Lord wasn't in it. When you go beyond your mercy, you're in sin. Okay, you're going to have to give me a minute. I got to find this sheet. My fingers don't work the way they used to. And I'm this is the blessing part of this message. The blessing over your heart. To have a tranquil heart is life to the body. But jealousy is rottenness to the bones. See it? Okay. One of them is working for you. One of them is working against you. Alright? Now, this is another translation, but look at the way he says it. A sound heart is the life of the flesh, but envy is rottenness of the bones. That's still in Proverbs 14:30. So, let me talk to you about soundness a minute. Soundness, this word is not used elsewhere in the New Testament. I'll read that scripture to you in a minute. It denotes integrity of parts, freedom from any defects, and here means that the cure was perfect and entire. Now, this word soundness is used in Acts 3:16. And what that was Peter and John went to pray, and they met a blind man on the way. Or they met a fellow that was lame on the way. You remember that? In Acts chapter 3? And what did Peter say? And he thought he was going to get it. What? She got the rest of the song. Now, Peter said it in Acts 3:16, and his name, through faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know, yea, and faith, the faith which is by him has given him this perfect soundness in him. Acts 3:16 is the only time that word is used in the New Testament. So this man got the perfect soundness. He got all the defects in his body taken care of. He got integrity of parts. Listen to what that's saying. The integrity of the parts of your heart need to be sound. And see, it doesn't mean God hasn't done a work in there to make your heart whole. But this means the enemy has been charging against you, and he's trying to destroy your heart so he can destroy you early and kill you early. And you're not going to die till it's time. Amen. Now, this word sound is an adjective. That means it's an active word. It's active all the time. The soundness is working from God to bring soundness into your heart. To bring soundness into your heart. And Satan trying to destroy it, lie to you, tell you you're stupid, and you're an idiot, and you're too young, and you're too old. Here you go, either way. You just believe it. A lady came, and she was 26 years old. She said, "My daddy told me I'd never amount to anything." Listen to that. Listen to that. You take that in. What's that going to do to your heart? After 6 years of marriage, she went back to her daddy and said, "He wants a divorce." You know what her daddy said? "I told you you'd never amount to anything. He needed to be shot." We broke that off of her. 3 months later, I said, "How you doing?" She says, "I found Jesus. I found Jesus." You won't get that from the Lord. You won't get that negative trash from the Lord. You won't get it from Jesus. You won't get it from angels. You won't get it from heaven. And Jesus has been sent to change heaven and to change the earth. And it shouldn't be in the church. Active. Active word. Soundness is good conditioning. It's solid and it's strong. That's the condition that God wants to use on your heart. It's health for your heart. It frees you from mistakes. How many of you are guilty of the mistakes you've made? And got in your heart. Get it out of there today, Robin. All those mistakes are gone. Full definition. Free from injury or disease. Free from flaw, defects, and decay. See, when you give God money, what does it say? It can't decay up here. It won't rust out up here. Hello? Are you all with me today?
Yes.
All right, come on, stand up. Free from flaws, defects, and decay. Solid, firm, stable. Free from error. I meet some people all the time, and they're so busy saying they're sorry, they can't say anything else. I'm sorry. Oh, did you want two of those? I only gave you one. I'm sorry. So what are you doing? There's a problem there. You have to be sorry about everything? Come on, just think about that. How many times do you say that? I'm sorry, I didn't mean to do it that way. You're bigger than that. You don't have to be sorry about everything over and over and over and over and over. When you do make a mistake, well, I made a mistake. Let's correct it. I did it wrong. Let's say it right. Okay, and go on. But you know, God dealt with something with me after the January episode. Guilt, condemnation, and shame. Remember those three? I was constantly condemning myself. I was guilty of everything. And I had some hidden shame. I dealt with it. Now, here's what I want to break off with you. And you have to help me. Anything in you, in your heart, that's not sound. That's not the soundness of God. I want you to break it off in your heart. I break it off in my heart. Anything that's not sound in Jesus Christ's name. Anything that's not of integrity that's in my heart, I break it off in my heart. Anything that's worry and shame, I break it out of my heart in Jesus Christ's name. All the lies that I have accepted from people or from parents or from whoever it was, I break those lies out of my heart in Jesus Christ's name. I receive the perfection of your soundness, Lord, into my heart, in the name of Jesus. That's the Holy Spirit, right there. And he's working on the physical heart too, right there. That heart of God is being established in you. And your blood is clean in the name of Jesus. And your physical heart is open to the Lord to work and flow by the Holy Spirit. anything that is deteriorating me in my heart is broken off of my heart in Jesus Christ's name. My heart is healed and whole and well. I break it out of all disappointments that I know about and the ones I don't know about. I break it out of all words spoken over my heart that became arrows that hit me in the back are broken off of me in Jesus Christ's name. I break it out of all deafness over my heart in Jesus Christ's name. Anything out of order, anything out of order with my heart is healed right now. In the name of Jesus. I receive solid, good conditioning for my spiritual heart and my physical heart. Now say this if you're ready. If you're not ready, don't say it. I'm ready to do what you have for me to do, Lord. Sleep is deep, it's undisturbed, and it's sound sleep. In Jesus' name, amen. All rottenness to your bones is broken off of you, and we pray for a new bone marrow. Just flow into your bone in the name of Jesus. You are tranquil, quiet, and peaceful. You're free from agitation of the mind and spirit. You have self-assurance like never before. All disturbance and turmoil is taken from you. You are steady and you are stable from this day forward in the name of Jesus Christ. You are a partaker of Christ who is holding you in his confidence and his steadfastness. And your heart will not be hardened ever again against him in Jesus Christ's name. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Can you say I receive?
I receive.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen. God bless you. Thank you.